So let's get started. It's my pleasure to present to you some of the latest regulatory updates for CFDA registration. And let's dive into it. So I'll start off with some of the basics, including the annual report, and then I'll continue with some frequently asked questions that we get asked a lot, including cost and timeline for registration. Then I'll cover the latest regulatory updates, and we'll finish with some do's and don'ts, a couple things that I'd like to draw your attention to that you have to be careful of. Okay, so China's medical device market, there are several key drivers that are pushing forward the growth of China's medical device industry, including the 13th five-year plan and the Healthy China 2030 project. It was originally launched in 2016, and it aims to improve the national health. China really is trying to strengthen the international cooperation and exchange. So this is a very positive development. The medical device sales reached 370 billion RMB. RMB is the Chinese currency, and the currency, for anyone who doesn't know, the currency exchange rate from RMB to Euro is 8. And it's actually expected to account for 25% of the world's medical device market by 2050. So this is a very positive development. The market competition is strong. However, usually the domestic manufacturers, focus more on the low and mid section, while the foreign businesses tend to concentrate on the high level medical devices. And then there's obviously the regulations that constitute a great obstacle. There's tighter examinations of medical device requirements, and there's constant updates, you know, from one day to the other of the regulatory framework. So it can be a little bit daunting if you think of entering the Chinese market. But if you take steps to prepare for the market and are aware of the regulatory challenges, maybe with help of a partner or consultancy, then it's definitely possible, and China gives great business opportunities. Now let's have a look at the annual report released by the CFDA. CFDA stands for China Food and Drug Administration. And here you can see these five countries also top the international medical technical industry. How many people apply for certificates, and how many do get approved? Last year, CFDA accepted more registrations than in the prior year. Nevertheless, 338 were rejected. So there's always a couple that do not manage to attain a certificate, unfortunately. And here you can see what type of applications, what type of applications they are made up of. So renewals, initial administrations, and changes. But I will explain these to you a little bit later on. The majority is foreign manufacturers and also medical devices in comparison to IVDs. Now I'd like to introduce to you the regulatory bodies in China. There is, for instance, the Center for Medical Device Evaluation, short CMDE, or the National Institute of Food and Drug Control. But the authority that I'd like to focus on today is the CFDA, the China Food and Drug Administration. It was established in 1998 by the State Council and was renamed in 2013. Actually, it was more than just renamed. A lot of you might be aware of the scandals, the negative headlines that China made over the years about tainted or contaminated food or medicine or even infant formula that caused a lot of infant deaths and illnesses, which is very tragic. So in order to start anew and separate itself from past scandals, the SFDA was renamed to CFDA, what we know it today. And the authority now has a more internal structure and oversight than ever before. There are actually 17 departments and 19 institutes within the CFDA, and it's directly under the control of the Chinese Ministry of Health and the State Council. Its task is to administer and supervise the organization, to draft regulations for medical devices, to classify medical devices, etc. And the different product ranges the CFDA is responsible for are pharmaceuticals, medical devices, cosmetics, and health foods. And a lot of things change a lot in the regulatory world. So the newest one is infant formula. As of the 1st of January 2018, infant formula has to also be registered and certified in China. So here is a quick comparison of the risk classes in China and Europe. As you can see, usually the European classes can translate to the Chinese risk classes. However, when you look at the EU class 2, you're never quite sure what your product will be classified as. There's always exceptions possible. One example would be dental cements and restorative materials. In the EU, they're classified as 2, and in China, they're classified as class 3. So the CFDA determines the actual classification with regard to the very specific scope of the application of the medical device, and it really depends on each individual case. The medical devices are classified based on the method of use, whether it's active or non-active, and whether it touches the human body or not. Non-active medical devices in this case would be functioning by human force or gravity and not by means of electricity or other energy sources. Now let's have a look at this table. I have a total of 4 of these. So the first one is body contacting and non-active. A good example for this would be a reusable surgical device. And as you can see, for long-term use, mostly it's classified as class 3. Now let's continue with body contacting active. One example here would be an implantable device, and it can't be classified lower than 2. So it's usually 2 or 3, but never class 1. A non-body contacting device that is not active are devices, for instance, that are used for sterilizing and cleaning other medical devices. And there it really depends on the impact it has, whether it's little, minor, or significant impact. And similarly, with the last one, the non-body contacting and active one, one example would be a standalone software. With classifications, if it can be classified as more than one class, it's always the highest. If your medical device includes multiple devices, then the highest has to be applied to all of them. And sterile medical devices cannot be classified lower than class 2. Let's move on. I'd like to introduce to you the different procedures of certification, application, and attainment. We usually distinguish between class 1 and then class 2 and 3, which is always a little bit harder. Class 1 actually only requires a notification, not a registration, just a filing, a notification, which is valid indefinitely, so there's no expiry date. That's why there's no renewal. And then I'll talk about renewal for class 2 and 3, and then extensions and changes. So this is how a certificate of notification looks like for a class 1 device. So this is what kind of information you can find on there. And let's have a look at how you can apply for one. First, you need to prepare the application documents. Then you compile the technical requirements, you get them notarized, and finally, you have to submit them personally at the CFDA. Personally means for every application, you can't do yourself, you actually have to have a CFDA legal agent, which is a legal entity in China. And in total, this application process takes about 7 weeks, and then you hopefully get your certificate, your notification with a stamp right away if all the documents are sufficient. Let's talk about the extension. Extension, let me explain to you what that means. So let's say you already have a medical device, you already have a valid notification or certificate, and then you want to extend that to another device within your product range, which is either the same or has a little bit smaller application scope. It can't be more complex, it has to be a little bit less intricate. And now let's move on to registration. So now we will be talking about class 2 and 3 medical devices. Here, this is a typical example of a certificate of registration and the information that are given on there. And the procedure is a little bit longer. So first you obviously compile some documents. The user manual is the first step, usually. Try to get your hands on the user manual as soon as possible, because it is indispensable for compiling the technical requirements. And then you can continue to confirm the sample parts that are required at the test center. Then you transport the samples, you import them into China, you transport them, and then the tests, the type tests, are being conducted. The type tests take about 16 weeks, and it's very useful to compile the application dossier during the type tests. This way you can save a lot of time. And some products do need to go through a clinical trial, or a clinical evaluation, but I will explain to you a little bit later on how you can determine whether you need to undergo a clinical trial or not. If possible, you want to avoid doing it, because it can be very expensive and very time consuming. Then you provide the registration documents to the CFDA, which then does the first review. If there's any documents missing, then you will receive a supplementary notice, and you have the possibility to, you know, support give them the supplementary documents or information that is required, and then the CFDA will do a second review. However, be careful, you can't go on for this forever. The CFDA will only do 2 reviews. So after the supplementary notice, you really want to have your documents together. Okay, in total this takes about 75 weeks or 115 weeks with a clinical trial. Of course, these information are based on our experience and can take much longer if things go wrong, but in theory it should be possible to go through the registration application process in this time. Let's have a look at a case study about the determination of registration units, which can save a lot of effort and money. So there was a company, let's call it Company One, that wants to register models of capillary blood collection tubes. And then we always try to reduce the cost. Everyone wants to do that, of course. And we discovered that actually the mode of use, the application of it, very similar. So we ended up talking to the experts from the Center for Medical Device Evaluation, because there has been no past experience about this. This product has never been in the Chinese market before. And luckily, they confirmed with us that it's possible to register all the products within one big unit, which saved our customer a lot of money. Also, saves a lot of effort. Now, let's talk about the renewal. The renewal is very important because the certificate is only valid for 5 years. And actually, you want to make sure that you apply in advance. So in theory, if you apply 6 months before the registration expires, you're okay. If you miss that deadline, you have to apply for a new registration, which is a lot more expensive and takes more time. What we do, we usually remind our customers 2 years beforehand. Because if the technical standards change, then you have to do type tests and other tests again, so it can take actually a lot longer than a lot of people expect. Or if the standards don't change, 1 year should be sufficient. This is the procedure. Again, you prepare documents, you compile the technical requirements and get them notarized, you submit them, you have the chance of supplementary submission, and then you get the certificate. This takes about 70 weeks. The extension for class 2 and 3 devices is very similar to the extension of class 1 devices that I explained to you earlier. So basically you extend your valid certificate of one medical device to another model of your product range, but the product must not be more complex. It has to be the same or less indications. It must have less indications. But it is low cost, it saves you application fees. However, the regulations are getting more restrictive. It's still worth giving it a try. This takes about 68 weeks. And for company two, we were able to use a extension to save money and time as well. So because they had a certificate that was valid until 2021, and because the product specification was the same or simpler, the application scope and the operation method are less or the same, then that is definitely something to look out for. Administrative change I've not told you so far. For instance, our change of name or address of the manufacturer or of the legal agent. It's pretty straightforward, it takes about 6 weeks. Let's take a change of legal agent as an example. There you, if the documents are correct, then the change is accepted by the CFDA without even involving the old agent. Because there's no CFDA regulations restricting the change of legal agent. However, be cautious, because if you do see yourself changing your legal agent, the actual administrative change is easy, but if you then want to do a renewal or extension for your product, your old legal agent still holds some of the very important original documents. And if your old legal agent is not cooperative, then that could actually cause a lot of issues and might lead to you actually having to apply for an entire new registration, which is not desirable. Okay, let's move on to tests and clinical trials. There are test standards in Europe and in China. There are identical or equivalent in many cases. Number one is not considered a type test, it's a quality management standard. Number two and three are also important standards in type tests for active devices. As of this year, they're free of charge, which sounds fantastic. caused a lot of issues, however, because the type test laboratories ended up striking, causing many delays. The electronic safety of active medical devices for Europe and China are about 85%. Similar, this is an estimation by us, so they're just equivalent. Number four is a biological standard. It's only used in combination with body contacting medical devices and still has test fees. And number five is a risk management standard. So the type test process is pretty straightforward. You have to determine the test samples together with the laboratory. You get the samples imported into China, delivered to the labs. There you negotiate over the contract, and after the fees are transferred, the tests are being conducted. Here, it's quite useful if you have a good if your legal agent has a good relationship with the laboratories, because the transparency is not so good. So if you have a good relationship, you can always ask, okay, how far along are our products in the test, what's going on, which is always nice. The type test report is valid for 1 year and you need it for your application. So don't waste time, so try to compile documents as the type tests are happening. This is really a good method. On these things I've already said, the close exchange is very beneficial. These are the 10 most important laboratories in China. All these information you can also find on the CFDA website. If you want to take a picture, you can also find it online. This is how a test report looks like with these information. And now, I've already mentioned it briefly earlier. How do I know whether I require a clinical trial? First, you have a look whether your product is on the clinical trial exemption list. If it is, perfect, no clinical trial needed. If it's not, then you ask yourself, are there maybe similar products on the market that have been approved? If yes, then you ask yourself, are the differences between this already approved product and my product so big that they would cause a different outcome in a clinical trial? If yes, then you can't get around a clinical trial. If not, then you try to get access to the data of so-called similar products, of this so-called similar product. And if that's possible, then you just have to submit a clinical comparison table and clinical evaluation report, which is much less expensive and time-consuming. The clinical trial exemption list, which I just mentioned, is a list that is released in batches by the CFDA on a regular basis, and at the moment there are 775 class 2 and 171 class 3 products on there, and if you find your product on there, then you're very lucky. What is a similar product? I mentioned if you find a similar product and their data is accessible, you can also avoid a clinical trial. First, you have the common name has to be the same. It's a name list released by the CFDA. Then the structure and composition has to be the same. The operating principle and the disease pattern for which the medical device is used for. And to avoid a clinical trial, all of these above points need to be fulfilled. This is how the clinical trial procedure is. clinical trial test fees can vary vastly from 700,000 to 5 million renminbi. I will give more specific examples later. And the manufacturer is responsible for the organization, the implementation, the financing, and the monitoring of the trials. So first you apply for it, and then you have research meetings, ethical meetings, the actual test, the clinical trial is being conducted, and then obviously the data has to be analyzed. The clinical trials always have to be done by hospitals of stage 2 or 3, never stage 1. And if it's an invasive product, then it has to be done by hospitals of stage 3A, which is the highest level. Let's talk about factory inspections. This is mainly interesting if you have products that are being manufactured in China, because usually the factory inspections are only done for domestic manufacturers within 2 or 3 working days, usually done by 3 experts, and so far there have actually been no audits for foreign manufacturers. The CFDA always says, oh, soon we will do factory inspections, but so far there has been none. Ever. Let's talk about some frequently asked questions that we get confronted with a lot. And the first one would be cost and approximate timeline if everything runs smoothly. Here you can see class one, you know, there is no official fees, but of course things like notarization of the documents will cost money. But there's no official CFDA fee for the application. And for class 2 new registration and for class 3 new registration, you will be able to see that they're much more expensive than a renewal or an extension. That's why always be cautious of the expiry date of your certificates. Good. The clinical trials, here are 3 examples of some customers we helped in the past. One class 2 and 2 class 3 medical devices that had to undergo a clinical trial. These were the costs that they were faced with. As I mentioned earlier, the type tests, apart from the biological one, are free of charge. And very specific, but just as a side notice, there are 8 very high-risk medical devices where the price was fixed. And this now is the chart for domestic products. The one that I showed you earlier was for foreign products. This is the one for domestic products manufactured in China. Here, class 2 is dependent on the province, because the all foreigners have to apply for their certificate at the CFDA in Beijing. The same applies for domestic class 3. But domestic class 1 and 2 apply for their certificate at their local FDA. And that's why the different provinces have different prices. What documents do you need for the application? Every case is different. Every application has individual requirements depending on the class, the product, the category, and you should know the structure of the very specific application scope for your own scenario very well in order to know what documents you need. And either you know this, or your partner knows this and is an expert in it, or you need a consultant, and this is the checklist, the file checklist that we provide our customers with, like templates and things that they have to prepare. A lot of people approach us and ask about the so-called green channels. We've heard there's a faster application procedure where it works easier. This applies to innovative devices. It sounds great, However, if I may draw your attention to the fact that last year only 9 devices in total were able to use the screen channel, it's actually quite unlikely that this is a possibility. But if it is, then congratulations, of course. Fantastic. And now I'd like to talk about the latest regulatory updates. In China, they literally change from day to day, and most of the time the regulations are implemented from one day to the other, immediately or shortly after the publication, but usually there's not much time for you to prepare for this. One example I mentioned earlier, type tests. From one day to the other, suddenly type tests were for free, causing strikes and a lot of delays in the application because no one could foresee it. However, there is a positive development because the dialogue between the manufacturers and the authorities is being expanded. So usually now, or very often, the CFDA releases a draft, which is then open for public opinion, and then they take this into consideration when they actually for the actual official standard. And because every medical device has to be registered, and there have been a lot of flaws that people or that the authorities pointed out, there have been many new updates, and I just picked a handful from the last a couple months, and I will also just introduce a couple here. So if you look at the first one here, the State Council Decree 680 decided that hospitals don't have to be accredited anymore. Hospitals that are responsible for the clinical trials, right? Because they now only have to be filed, it's much easier for hospitals, and you also have a much bigger pool available from which you can choose a hospital from. So this makes it a lot easier to undergo a clinical trial, to find a hospital at least. Then, if I may draw your attention to the third one, the CFDA announcement from the 11th of May. Here, this policy reforms the clinical trial management, where it was proposed that overseas clinical trial data is accepted in China if the clinical data meets the relevant Chinese requirements. But this would be great because then you can avoid the clinical trial. On the next page, let's have a look at the third batch that was released in May. This is the third batch of the clinical trial exemption catalog, and if you find your name or your product on this list, then you're lucky because you can avoid the trial. As you can see, there has been a lot of development and positive development where the authorities are really trying to make it easier to avoid the clinical trial or to undergo a clinical trial. Here, the third one from the top, the CFDA methods released in June the 2nd. The measures were introduced and talk about confidentiality, which is always a big concern for foreign manufacturers. And now the employees working in such authorities have to expect to have to expect with punishment and actual real consequences if they should violate any intellectual property rights. So this is a very positive development. And then the last one here, the CFD announcement 104, a new catalog, or a revised catalog of classification was released, which is much more extensive. It has 2,000 entries. The one before had 200. So now it's much easier to find your product and to know what class does my product fall into. And the latest regulatory update or policy that I'd like to mention to you is the one from the 10th of October, the notice about standardizing the classification. So if you do not find your product on the classification list, then you have this workflow and you can determine like what class your device is if it's not on this in the catalog. Okay, finally I'd like to address some do's and don'ts that you really should be cautious of. The first one is choose your CFTA legal agent wisely. You have three options. The first one, you have an own subsidiary, then that's obviously perfect. And you can go ahead because you have a reliable partner in China already. The second one, which a lot of people do, is they choose their distributor, but you have to be very cautious because the distributor will have the original documents, for instance, the original certificate. And if for whatever reason the relationship isn't good and he doesn't want to cooperate with you, then you might experience a lot of trouble if you want to undergo a renewal, etc. It's just a lot of disproportionate power. And if you're not able to have access to those certificates and you can't do a renewal, that might lead to a stop of delivery and the fact that you have to apply anew. The third option is a consulting company, which is a neutral partner. Obviously always has your best interest at heart and is independent, and then you can choose to have as many distributors or to choose distributors at any time. So really be cautious about your legal agent choice. Then a lot of people don't know, they actually need to have a Chinese label. This is how it looks like. This is an example of the information that will be given on your product. One thing that a lot of people ask us, what does the best before date mean? Best before date in this case can also be called the device lifetime, and you can choose which name you prefer, and you actually have to be able to prove that your device is still working properly beyond the device lifetime. Some things that you should avoid, forbidden claims that you should not mention on the packaging or on the label, are guarantees or things like comparisons or promises or misleading things. I mean, I don't think any one of you would like consciously do this, but it's easy to accidentally have a wording that then does not comply with the CFDA guidelines. So it's always better to have someone look over it, just to be safe. If there's infringements, so if there's irregularities, the CFDA can actually apply penalties. There was one example in 2015 where a manufacturer of a light microscope didn't comply with the requirements completely, and then as a result the CFDA imposed a warning first and then a trade ban and a confiscation of all the products and a big fine. So yeah, try not to get into trouble with the CFDA. And now I'd like to introduce a couple associations and websites that might be of interest to you. There's the China Association of Medical Device Industry. There is the China Medical Pharmaceutical Material Association, short CMPMA. There's the Chinese Association for Medical Equipment, the China Chamber of Commerce for Import and Export of Medicines and Medical Products, and some useful websites. One would be the Medical Device Information Network, then the CFDA one. Careful, the actual address still has the old SFDA in the name. And here you can also find the your device category. There are some very interesting fairs that you might want to consider visiting in mainland China. The one that I can really recommend is the China International Medical Equipment Fair. It is held twice. What I didn't write down here, the one in spring is held in Shanghai, the one in autumn is always in South China. It's not clear where that will be, but you can easily find this online. And if you're interested in dental devices, then these are the three dental fairs, and they're equally good. Just choose the one where maybe your distributor is, or, you know. Okay. The next year is the Chinese Year of the Dog. Maybe a little bit interesting information to you. It's a good year for lifestyle changes, and it's also a good year to start new business ventures. So it's the time to tap into the Chinese market. Yes, thank you so much for your attention. If you have any questions, the business founder and owner, Stefan Fischer, and I will be here for any questions you might have for at least another hour, so bombard us.